I am Philippe Eluy. I am applied mathematician in the University of Strasbourg, and I will present you a numerical simulation that we have made of conservation laws using OpenCL and MPI libraries. And it is a joint work with Thomas Trubb from the AxoSim company in Strasbourg. Many equations in physics are systems of conservation laws. So you have such a system written here. So it's a system of partial differential equations. And the main unknown of the system is W. So W is called the vector of conserved quantities. So it's a vector with m components. And this vector depends on a space variable x and on time. So this form of equation is very general, and you find many applications, for instance, in fluid mechanics, electromagnetics, and so on. So it's very important to provide efficient numerical solver, efficient and optimized numerical solver for solving such equations. So here is the outlines of my short talk. So in the first part, I will present you numerical simulations that we have made. Direction, you transpose again the matrix, and in this way you can have a good memory bandwidth and good efficiency. So this is the first very simple approach. You can improve the if you want to be faster or if you have big computations to perform. You can also use several GPUs. So you split your grid into several subdomains. So here you have four subdomains in this example. You can we associate one GPU to one subdomain, and we also associate each GPU to one MPI node. And then MPI, the MPI library, is used in order to exchange at the end of each time step data between the different GPUs. So here the data that are exchanged are the two. You have two cells layer on the two sides of the subdomain boundaries. Then we have implemented all this, and we can compare this implementation with a classic OpenMP implementation of the same algorithm. And we observe that we have, without modifying the OpenCL kernel and software, we are able to run the same implementation on different platforms. For instance, here you have two, you have Intel two Intel CPUs with six cores each. You can also run on NVIDIA K20 GPUs or on AMD GPUs, and you also here have an experiment with four NVIDIA K20 GPUs. And we see that we have obtained a good efficiency. And what is interesting too is that on the CPU run, you can see that with it's very comparable to the OpenMP implementation. You have a small, you lose a little bit performance because we perform a useless a matrix transposition in this version of the algorithm, and the transposition is not required in the OpenMP implementation. So let's go and see some numerical simulations that we have made with this approach. Which I've tried to, yes, it's already prepared here. So the conservation law that is solved here is fluid mechanics. So it represents, it is a shock waves coming on a gas bubble, and the shock waves is propagating into a liquid medium. And you can see that the shock wave is coming on the bubble, and the bubble is shrinking. And at a given time, it will split into two parts, and then into four parts, and so on. So here, the computations are made on a rather coarse mesh, and it is performed on an AMD 5850 GPU. So it was a few years ago. And what is interesting here is that the GPU is doing all the work because you have the computation are made by the GPUs. You have also OpenGL, OpenCL interoperation for displaying the results. And it is not finished because the screen is also captured by the GPU. So here everything is made. Yes?
Are you doing
multi-material? Yes, we have two different materials. You have a gas and a liquid. So they have two different. You have two different equation of states.
Well, I know, but is it gamma log?
Yes, you can write the whole system as one system of conservation laws. Okay, so but you're right. We have multi-material. Okay, so we are able to compute this, but so it's funny because you have a video, but where is my talk? It's here. But what was more interesting, is that we were able to run the same case on several GPUs on very, very fine mesh. So here you have a 2D, I will show you 2D numerical simulation on a 40,000 times 20,000 grid. So it means that we have 4 billion unknowns per time step. And you need two vectors of such unknowns. So it's 8 billion unknown by time steps. And we run the computation on 10 NVIDIA K20 GPUs. And here you can see a view of the bubble at the split time. So you see you have very fine structures here. And because the grid is very fine, you can zoom. So first I will zoom on this region here. So you have a zoom on this region with small vertices here at the split region. And you can also zoom again on the two parts here and here. So to see that it can be very complicated, you have very complicated structures. So it's very interesting to have the possibility to perform very fine computations. So this was the first part of the talk. Now I come to the second part, which is how to generalize, how to have more flexibility in the representation of geometries. So for this, we decided to try to use unstructured meshes in order to represent more complex geometries. And we decided also to rely on hexahedron mesh because it allows to have some optimization with the OpenCL implementation. Data structure is very important when you are doing GPU computing. So we use the following framework. So first, we use subdomain decomposition in order to deal with large domain. So one domain corresponds to one MPI node and one OpenCL device. And then each domain is itself decomposed in several zones. So you have volume zones and interface zones. And you allow to have non-conformity between zones. So here you have an example of such meshes. So it's simple mesh, but you have an example. So you have one subdomain here with a fine grid behind. And in the front, you have one subdomain with two volume zones. And all these zones are separated by three interface zones. And here you see that you can have a stretch hexahedrons. So here you have another view of the data structure. So we have a volume zone. You use interface zone. They are used in order to exchange data between two volume zones. And you can also mix a coarse grid to fine grids. In each hexahedron, we use several interpolation points. So here you see that for one cell, we will sample the solution at the blue point here. And what is it, for more flexibility? We allow to have discontinuity at the green points so that you don't have to match the two zones in order to have more flexibility. So in order to deal with this kind of data structure, you need to use special meshes. So here you have what is called the discontinuous Galerkin formulation that is written here. So I don't enter into the detail, but what you have to retain that you have a volume term to compute. You have interface term to compute between two cells of the neighboring cells of the mesh, and you so this in the end when you discretize all this you end up with a a system of ordinary differential equations that you have to solve in time. And you also have to manage data exchange between a subzone and so how to do this? Maybe I can pass this because it's too long. But what is important is that you have many computations to do. So you have volume computation, you have interface computations, and you have data exchange between the zone and the subdomains. And in order to manage all this, we decided to rely on the OpenCL event management. So we're describing all the tasks that we have to do in order to perform the computation for one time step. So you have the task graph of all that you have to perform. You have a zoom on a task graph of one single subdomain. And for instance, what you observe that you can perform volume computation inside a volume zone while you are doing communication with the neighboring zones. And using the OpenCL events, it's possible to describe the dependency between the tasks. So the problem is how to... So you also have MPI communication, and the problem is how to make MPI and OpenCL discuss together. And what we have found, we have found this simple solution, which is to send when we want to have a MPI communication, we launch a thread, and in the thread we launch the MPI communication. So in this way, it is possible to continue the main program flow and launching other kernels. And when the MPI communication are finished in the thread, then we modify an OpenCL events in order to trigger all other computations. So in the end, we are able to obtain good performance. So here you have the comparison between the synchronous MPI implementation and the asynchronous MPI implementation. So we see that we obtain an interesting speed up. And with this, we were able to compute other system of conservation law. So here you have an example of an electromagnetic wave coming over an entire aircraft. So the mesh is inside the aircraft and outside the aircraft. So it's a very big mesh. And we use 8 GPUs in order to do the computations. And this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your attention.
Sticker, sticker. We have any questions?
So how do you determine the delta T? Is it automatic or it just predetermined?
Yes, it is automatic, yes. It depends on the wave speed of the models that you are studying.
Okay, so it guarantees that the delta T won't cause any non-convergence issue?
Yes, of course, we satisfy the CFL condition, but it depends on the system of conservation laws that you are solving. If you solve Maxwell's equation, for instance, the time step is limited by the speed of light, and if you solve a fluid mechanics, the time step is limited by the speed of sounds.
Hi, hello, Ruman from Coldplay. I was wondering, have you considered using higher level programming models rather than directly programming OpenCL and MPI?
Sorry, I don't.
Have you considered using higher level programming models rather than directly using OpenCL or an MPI? Something like OpenACC or Chapel or something? Because I guess that it is quite complicated to do this in such a low level.
Yes, I agree with you that OpenCL is rather low level, but for us it was very important to achieve almost the best possible performance. And for instance, all the data are always almost on the GPUs, and then they are copied to the GPU at the beginning of the computations, and they remain on the GPU during all the computation. So we wanted to stick to this in order to have very high performance.
So the limiting problem was the OpenCL kernel and not the domain decomposition?
Yes, we cannot balance automatically between subdomains, you're right.
Okay, let's thank our speaker again. We better move on.